Welcome back to Good Morning Kenya. This is Transformative Leaders on KBC Channel 1. My name is Mike Migwe, and today we are talking about peacekeeping and conflict resolution. And joining me for this conversation is none other than Dr. Ivan Yenda Ilunga, who is a professor of political science and international relations. Now, let's talk about the aspect of peacekeeping and conflict resolution. And Kenya has been involved in peacekeeping and conflict resolutions, especially in Africa. Do we have the right support as African countries in as far as this is concerned?
Well, thank you very much for having me here. And I think, yes, Kenya has been an instrumental player in advancing peacekeeping on the continent. But also, for the past couple of years, we've seen Kenya being very active at the regional level, especially when you think about cases such as the one in the DRC and other places. So yes, Kenya is an important actor, and I think it has also enjoyed the credibility as a country that is a strategic partner to many international organizations, and but also seen as an important actor in the region. So yes, Kenya is very instrumental in advancing peacekeeping and peace in general in the region. Yes.
Yes. When you talk about conflict resolution and the implementation of the same, what is the effectiveness of these efforts, and is the implementation being embraced across Africa?
Well, I think the first I think the first element is to say, and you have to acknowledge that many African countries these days are in trouble, and that is a fact. And these troubles are not only at the political level, but we also see them at the community level, where you have multi-dimensional conflict. You have ethnic conflict, you have conflicts related to natural resources, conflict related to classes, ethnicities, and so on. So advancing peace in Africa requires a holistic view. So for some places, it is about political instabilities. But for other countries and other regions and other communities, it's, for instance, about community stability. So do we have the right arsenal to address this conflict with? Yes, I think we do. But that requires an interest, I think, a well-deliberated engagement by countries, by one assessing the type of conflict that we see. So to your question, when you see, for instance, the ongoing engagements that many countries have these days, including Kenya, to address conflict in different parts of Africa, I think the approach that we are seeing, it's more, I would say, a top-down approach, where the idea is, if we fix the politics, if we fix the leadership, and if we harmonize misunderstanding between leaders, at least leading parties, then we'll be able to have peace. But which for me, I think, is not always the fact. Because yes, we have had in many countries, including, for instance, South Sudan and other places, where we have seen a political agreement being signed and implemented a little bit, but still conflict is occurring. Because communities are not satisfied. So to the point of effectiveness will require that we assess well the conflict. If we assess it well, we will know what type of resources to put in. And that also will create an environment where conflict resolution, through, for instance, dialogue, will be advanced properly.
Now, Kenya has also been involved in peacekeeping efforts. We have seen military interventions in some parts of Africa, and also we have our former president Uhuru Kenyatta, who is also involved in conflict resolutions, especially in DRC. How would you rate Kenya's efforts so far in as far as peacekeeping and conflict resolution is concerned?
Well, I'll say thank you. I think so far Kenya's involvement is positive. It's positive for a couple of reasons. One, when you see the framework of UN peacekeeping operations, especially in the past 20 years, we've seen many troop contributing countries coming from outside the continent. So we have countries such as Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan that have been providing troops in many peacekeeping missions in Africa. But that has shifted a little bit, and these days we have a tendency of seeing more African troops being deployed on African continent. That requires leadership, good training, and availability. And I think Kenya has demonstrated that the Kenya Defense Forces that are being deployed are available, they are under, I think, good leadership, and they are also performing well. So yes, Kenya has been instrumental in that. How do I rate it? You know, I think a matter of peace rating depend on one hand you have a mandate that the missions have, and on the other hand you have the local perception on what community expect. So on the mandate, under the, for instance, the East African Community Forces that was deployed to the DRC, if you think about the framework of the mandate and the resources that were put in, from the Kenya's perspective, one could say that was a positive mission, right? But when you see the broader aspect of stability which was needed and the local expectations in the DRC of seeing, for instance, violence being handed and also peace being restored, that rate may be a negative rate. It'll be like, well, it's probably 4 out of 10. At least the 4 is because we saw the troops on the ground and we saw the willingness to address, but peace is not restored. But when you go back to the institutional rating, I think Kenya's been doing okay. And that, for me, is more encouraging to see a country in Africa willing and ready to assist and support other countries in Africa, and even taking the bold step of trying to help other countries outside the continent. That tells at least an idea of leadership, an idea of willingness to advance peace, and that should be the first element to positively assess a mission or the willingness of a country. Is Kenya ready to navigate all these different terrain and fields? Because conflict changes all the time. That's another question that we may need to think about. And if the country is not fully ready, then what should we see being invested in the level of readiness of Kenya? But apart from that, I'm in academia, so I may say I will give at least an 8 or 8 out of 10 to the point that you see a readiness and deployment and the political statements that shows an idea of advancing peace on the continent.
Having said that, is there something that Kenya can channel into these efforts as a country? We are talking in terms of resources, human resource. Is there something extra that Kenya needs to do to be more proactive in as far as conflict and peace resolutions are concerned?
Yes, you know, when we talk about that today, we see it as issues, or we see that as issues that affect other countries. Yeah. But of course, instability in country A, in East Africa, is also instability in Kenya indirectly, because it affects the business, it affects the stability, it affects the entire life system. So yes, Kenya should be proactive in advancing stability and peace. What can Kenya do? And here, when I say Kenya, I personally don't only mean institutions. I also mean Kenyans. You know, I enjoy myself here because I can say jumbo, you know. In other words, I feel at home. So that means everything that's happening outside Kenya affects Kenyans as well, as brothers and sisters. So, and the intervention of Kenya outside of Kenya is not just an intervention in a foreign country. It's an intervention in our home lands. In other words, intervention where Kenya go and Kenyans go help their brothers and sisters somewhere else. So what can Kenya do? I think one is to, when you think about leadership, because you know we're talking about also transformational leadership, a leader can only be a leader if they know, first of all, their position. And Kenya and Kenyans need to understand that at this point in East African community, and even in Africa, Kenya has a leading position. And that has to be taken seriously. And if you know your position, then you need to decide on what type of resources to put in order to fulfill your leadership role. And is that economic leadership? Is that political leadership? Is that military leadership? On the economic side, on the finances, there are many. For instance, there is one Kenyan bank that I don't want to mention, but that is very much expanding on the continent, right? And that, it's a proof of saying Kenya's taking a step in engaging with the rest of the continent financially, economically, and so on. And that is a level of awareness that I think Kenya should have. Not just say, well, we are expanding because we are enjoying ourselves, but also expanding because we have the responsibility to engage with the rest of the continent and enable other countries to pick up their development, to pick up their stability. And if the DRC, for instance, is stable, well, the DRC, specifically the eastern part of the DRC, is stable, then that will be an easy opportunity for Kenya and Congolese to engage in trade, to engage in other type of development, including technological development and other opportunities. Yeah. So there is a stake for Kenya in peace in Africa.
Yeah. Now, Kenya and also in Africa, we have countries that are multi-ethnic. Mm-hmm. And this is where and multi-ethnicity sometimes is one of the reasons that can lead to conflicts, because one party may feel like they are being shortchanged in terms of resources, governance, and things like that. So how do you approach conflict resolution in such a situation?
I think we have the blessing in Africa of being diverse. And some people consider it as a curse and trouble, but for me, I consider it as a blessing because there is richness in diversity. The Berlin Conference divided the continent in small pieces. And unfortunately, that subdivisions of the continent did not always take into consideration ethnic differences and ethnicities and ethnic lines. Post 1884, 1885, we find ourselves in a continent, in countries where we are forced to live together. And here I'm using my word carefully. We are forced to live together, not deliberately decided to be in one place. And 1960s, we gained our independences, and that led to an idea of trying to build nations. And we are so proud of our borders. We are so proud of our countries. And that itself tells us that we are destined to live together as diversities, ethnic tribes and so on. Is it easy? Not at all. It's not easy. You know, I always say, you know, you may be, just think about family situations where you have siblings who behave some way, and but that doesn't mean they are not your siblings. That doesn't mean you should kick them out. So you have to live together. And when you think about conflict resolution, I always want people to bring it down to the family settings first. Because when we think about country, we think about numbers of people. We think about the numbers of tribes, And it's like, it's too much. But bring it down first to just the family setting. Either it's 11 people, 4 people, 5 people. We all have differences, but we try to work out those differences. And it is a great opportunity for Africa outside any other part of the world. When I do my studies and research in conflict resolutions and peace, I see it as a tool that Africa has in order to strengthen a new vision of the world. We have managed to live together. And, of course, the conflict is there. There is issues of representation, which need to be addressed, because there are certain grievances which are valid. You have probably a small group or a majority that's taking over power for a long time, and then, of course, the other feel alienated and so on. Those are issues, and those are reality in some spaces. And we have to acknowledge that some people have been deprived from the benefit of enjoying their presence in certain countries. But how can we create an environment where everyone feels welcome and seen and represented? This is the step in conflict resolution based on diversity that I think Africa and African spaces and African countries should look at. If I may push a little bit on that, you know, we always say, what can Africa offer to the world? This is one of the gift of diversity. You know, we have managed to live together despite our differences. Today we are talking about the globalization, you know, where people go in different places. You have now Western countries not knowing how to deal with migrants, people from different backgrounds in the same place. They're just like, well, it's too much. We cannot. We don't have the right legal setting and setup for all these people because they come with different culture, different values. But Africa has already had that experience many years ago before even we declare globalization. Yes. So we have the opportunity, at least at this time, to teach also the world how to live together, because we have managed over the centuries to do that. And of course, we went through conflict, but we resolved them.
Now, approaching the aspect of peace and conflict resolution cannot be done from a lone ranger perspective. We've seen efforts of former President Uhuru in DRC, but he also leads a team of other people from various countries in Africa, and also the aspect of peacekeeping troops in the DRC. It's a multinational force. Mm-hmm. So I'd love for you to talk about the synergy between governments, policymakers, private sector, the civil society. What is their role, and what is the importance of that synergy in as far as conflict resolution and peace is concerned?
Yeah, great question. I think it is a mistake to think that peace can only be restored through military capabilities. Because most of the reasons of instabilities are not military reasons. They are economic reasons, they are social reasons, they are political, they are cultural. So if we think about those reasons from that angle, and it's because they were not well addressed that instability occurred, violence erupted, and we need peacekeepers, we need the military to intervene to stabilize. But the trend that we are seeing today is a multidimensional approach to peacekeeping and peace building. The former president is engaged into diplomatic space where he engages with different actors in the regions and talk through, bring some to their sense, and so on. That is one aspect. The other aspect, which is a fact, that the threat that we see today, you have terrorist organizations, armed groups that are not willing to obey any law. Those ones need to be neutralized. And that's where we have the military capabilities of peacekeepers being expected to engage. But beyond that, natural resources-based conflict will only be addressed when there is a clear framework of redistribution of resources. Issues of poverty are being addressed. And so, yes, those are angles. And this requires involvement of different stakeholders. I'll start probably quickly with civil societies. Think about religious leaders. How vocal are they? And how credible are they in many communities? People believe in religious leaders more, sometimes more than politicians.
Yeah.
So we need to bring them into these conversations. I always say this idea of saying we have to separate, you know, religion from politics. For me, I think it's a wrong idea, because religion is already politics, and politics already part of the religious spaces. Yeah. So religious leaders need to be engaged. You know, it's interesting when you see official events, especially all these big official events in many African countries. Mm-hmm. One of the steps that we see happening, you have the open prayers, mm-hmm. right? You have religious leaders from different organizations coming and doing the opening prayers. And then you move into the official steps. So that tells us the place that our society has for religious organizations and the religious leaders. And this is where, for me, I think engaging religious leaders, and I'm writing a book on that, the role of religious leaders in peacekeeping. So how do we tap into their credibility, their trust, and their access in communities to advance conversations that cannot be advanced by politicians, cannot be advanced by the military? So, and I guess the last part of your question was, for instance, mentioning the private sector. Mm-hmm. Investment is key for any community. So we cannot, unfortunately, there is this idea of saying we cannot invest in a fragile space because money does not like the sound of guns. Mm-hmm. But I think for me, the idea of investing in a private sector as part of the peace building process is important.
Yes. Now, what is the place of research in all this?
Well, I would say research is important on academic level as well as a policy level. For us to have a good policy decision, it has to be a well-informed decision. And this is where research comes in. Research allows policymakers to reflect on issues, not from superficial things, but with data, saying, well, we can't just say 50 people have been killed. But research allows us to go beyond the numbers to see what are the dynamics of those, for instance, massacres or those type of things. So research allows very much to inform policies. And as you can tell, many institutions, either government or non-government, these days have a research component because it's allowing a well-informed decision-making process.
Talk about the stabilization of operations in terms of peacekeeping conference that is coming up soon.
Yeah, great. No, thank you. So there is a peacekeeping stabilization conference that is happening in Nairobi, and it brings together different stakeholders, businesses, policymakers, government officials, civil societies, and academicians around the table to assess the situation on the continent and then see where is Africa in terms of peacekeeping and what type of support can we put into it in order to advance peace. So we've had, for instance, Kenyan officials and other officials attending and presenting their views on how that synergy we're mentioning early can be happening to facilitate the right resources, mobilize the finances, the logistics, and also mobilize key players, key leaders to engage in peace building across the continent.
What, in your own assessment, What do you hope to be the outcome of all this of this conference?
Well, my first interest and hope is that this will not be the first, right? It should be an opportunity for many more. And the most important thing is to have different stakeholders taking their leadership positions and engage into this area of peacekeeping. Because over the years, we've had only the military and a little bit of politics involved and not the business side, because some businesses feel like peacekeeping is not part of what they're doing. But the reality is there is room for everyone if we want to advance peace and stability. So my hope is to see a better engagement of civil societies, private sectors, academicians, policymakers coming together around the table and have one voice. I would say there is hope for Africa. And this is one of the greatest opportunities for the continent to show its abilities for change. No one will do it better than Africans. And it's not about bragging. It's about being aware that Africa has a lot to offer. It's time for us to switch the mind from the receiving continent to the giving continent and identify what we have to give and boldly give to the world what the world has been waiting for so many years.
We have been talking to Dr. Ivan Yenda Ilunga, who is an assistant professor of political science and international relations. This has been Transformative Leaders here on Good Morning Kenya. My name is Mike Migwe. Keep it KBC Channel 1.